Tonight we're going to be talking here at prayer meeting about the sufficiency of Scripture. The sufficiency of Scripture. Probably it's something we at least mentally give assent to. And maybe you've wondered, why do we believe this? Why do we believe the Scripture is sufficient? Well, maybe we believe it because Ellen White told us we could believe it. Or maybe we believe it because it's in some catechism or church manual or something. But I think we're going to find out that the Scripture itself presents itself as being sufficient for all the needs of our faith and life. I'd like to begin by turning to Deuteronomy chapter 12 and verse 32. Notice he says here, "What things soever I command you, observe to do it. Thou shalt not add thereto, nor diminish from it." If we're not going to add to it, or we're not going to diminish from it, then surely, friends, it must be sufficient for us, or God has left us shorthanded. We are not to change it. Now, there's an interesting text that I'd like to combine with this in the book of Joshua. It's in Joshua chapter 1. So just a few pages over from where we were in Deuteronomy. Joshua chapter 1, verses 7 and 8. He says, "Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success." Joshua says that we are to meditate on the book of the law. That would be referring to the Pentateuch, the things that have been written prior to this. Day and night. Now, sometimes we hear this term meditate, and it may have a bad connotation. Because maybe we've heard associated with the term transcendental meditation, where sometimes people just sort of sit and get into like what they call a Zen-like state, and they're really not thinking about anything. But the Scripture here tells us that meditation of itself is good if it's in the Word of God. Now, I came across a news article this last week. Jeffrey James had written this article, and I found it in two or three locations. I first found it in Apple News, but then I traced it down also to a website that's dnyuz.com, anyhow. But it's on the health of the brain. And he speaks about the former Apple co-founder, Steve Jobs. And so I'm just going to read to you what he said. It's pretty interesting, and then we'll make some comments. "In the past, I've written explained how Steve Jobs used Zen mindfulness to train his brain, and also how neuroscience has recently proved that Jobs' theory about the business benefits of meditation turned out to be scientifically correct. There was one thing, however, that Jobs didn't know, although he might have guessed it to be true. Meditation does more than just calm you down and make you, as Jobs intuited, a better manager. Meditation literally causes your brain to age backwards. Under normal circumstances, brains deteriorate as they age. According to Psychology Today, the deterioration of the brain has many symptoms. Reflexes become slower. Memory starts to fail. It becomes harder to learn new things. Thinking becomes brittle. Mental stamina declines." He continues, "These symptoms become measurable as early as age 45, at which point most people have already experienced a 3-4% decline in mental agility, and it's all downhill from there. By age 60, the changes are usually obvious. By age 70, they're often debilitating. Studies have shown that eating well, exercising, and learning new things can ameliorate these difficult symptoms. However, It appears that even when you manage your symptoms, your brain continues to deteriorate. There is, however, apparently at least one way to not just stop the deterioration process, but to put it into reverse. A study conducted at the Massachusetts General Hospital and Harvard Medical School found that meditating for 30 minutes each day for 8 weeks does the following. And Harvard Medical School is not necessarily a bad place to have studies. It's a pretty reputable place. Well, here's what they say it does. Now, I have some slides here, and let me bring those slides back up for those who can see them. These are just some pictures of sections of the brain. And this first is the posterior cingulate. And it says that this meditation for 30 days for 8 weeks thickened the posterior cingulate, thereby increasing focus and self-confidence. The next slide shows the location of the hippocampus, and there's like a left and a right side, but it says it thickened the left hippocampus, thereby increasing the ability to regulate emotion, to learn, and to remember. And there's another one here, and this one's a little harder to pronounce, so I'll be slow on it. But it thickened the temporoparietal junction, thereby increasing empathy, compassion, and perspective. These are all little sections of your brain. It shrank the amygdala, thereby decreasing stress and likelihood of a flight or fight response. It goes on to say, or conclude, meditation is so effective at repairing damage that it can make your brain as much as 25 years younger than your chronological age. Since Steve Jobs was a regular meditator when he died at 56 of pancreatic cancer, his brain was as healthy, active, and creative as when he was much younger, which shows, I think, in the quality of his work, which continued to be superlative right up to his untimely end. And that's an interesting thought, because those who understand or know a little of the history of Steve Jobs know that he was quite a productive person mentally up till the time he died. He had these visionary ideas, creating products and services. And he did this, you know, through, at least to a degree, through keeping his brain active through meditation. Now, he was meditating on other things, anything probably other than the Bible. But my thinking is this. We know that scientifically, when people meditate, the brain changes. We know that. So if it changes in these positive ways, meditating upon things that are not really of super value, it must change even better and change more productively when we're meditating upon the Word of God. Now, something to keep in mind is that if we're practicing meditation, whether it's through prayer and the Word of God or through something else, our brains are probably getting healthier. They probably are getting sharper. And that's a two-edged sword, because we are creating a tool whereby we may either serve evil better or serve God better. And hopefully we all want to serve God better. But just remember that if we're spending time in this kind of a situation, it's not necessarily good for us if we're not putting it into the Word of God. Now, the Hebrew word that's translated meditate in Joshua is hagah. And it's found in other places in the Bible. And I just want to show you a few places. In Psalms chapter 1 and verse 2. Psalms chapter 1 and verse 2. I'll read verse 1 with it. It says, "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in what? The law of the Lord, and in his law doth he what? Meditate." How often? Day and night. More than 30 minutes a day for 8 weeks. And so there we find this usage. In chapter 2 and verse 1, we find this word, hagah, but it's translated a little differently here. And remember I said that this meditation could be a two-edged sword? So notice in Psalms 2 and verse 1, it says, "Why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing?" But the Hebrew word that we translate imagine is hagah. It's the same word that's translated meditate in Joshua 1. So he says, "Why do the heathen meditate on a vain thing. There's no good help in meditating upon something that's vain. In Psalm 63, and I'm going to read a little bit of this to get the context, but we're going to be particularly focusing on verse 6 and then into 7. But we're going to start in verse 1. Psalm 63, verse 1. O God, thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is. To see thy power and thy glory, so as I have seen thee in the sanctuary. Because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee. Thus will I bless thee while I live. I will lift up my hands in thy name. My soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise thee with joyful lips. Verse 6. When I remember thee upon my bed and meditate on thee in the night watches. Because thou hast been my help, therefore in the shadow of thy wings will I rejoice. And so David speaks here about meditating upon God and his works and his greatness through the night watches. Sometimes the soldiers would be up all night watching, you know, they would have to station watches. And he says this would be, you know, what he could do through the night watches. There's an interesting text, Psalm 77:13. I think we are very familiar with that text, Psalm 77:13. But let's look at the verse just before it, verse 12. He says, I will meditate also of all thy work and talk of thy doings. And so again, this is where we are to focus and to keep our minds upon the Scripture, upon the Word of God. Psalms 143 and verse 5. Psalms 143 and verse 5. He says here, I remember the days of old. I meditate on all thy works. I muse on the work of thy hands. And so again, you know, there are so many things that we can meditate upon in this world. So many things to think on. Think of all the social media that's available. You know, I don't even know what the names of all of them are, but I know there's like Facebook and Instagram and Snapchat. Is that what, right? You know, there are YouTube videos by the millions, there's podcasts by the millions, all kinds of things you can listen to. But the great thing to meditate upon is the Word of God. And I tell you, if we were meditating upon it more, if we were studying it more and thinking about it and putting our minds more, we'd be a greater, stronger people. In Proverbs 15:28, it says, the heart of the righteous studieth to answer, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things. But that word studieth, in the Hebrew, is that hega. It's that word that we translate meditate. So we could simply translate the heart of the righteous meditates, or he studies, he wants to know what the answer is. He makes it a part of his life. And one of the reasons that we can do this and incorporate the Scriptures like this is because the Scripture is purified. It is holy and it is good. In Proverbs chapter 30 and verses 5 and 6, he says here, every word of God is what? It's pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. And then he says, add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. So we're not to reprove or take the word of God away. We are to give the word of God. Do you remember when Jeremiah was called to be a prophet? And at first during his call, he said, Lord, I'm just a child. And the Lord said, I knew you before you were born. And I put my words in your mouth. But I want you to notice a specific command that God gave Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 26 and verse 2. Jeremiah chapter 26 and verse 2. Thus saith the Lord, stand in the court of the Lord's house and speak unto all the cities of Judah which come to worship in the Lord's house. All the words that I command thee to speak unto them, diminish not a word. Jeremiah was to speak the words that God gave him and not to diminish a single one. And so again, we have the Word of God and it's sufficient. We share it. And he says, don't diminish a word of it. Now, the New Testament record shows the completion and the fulfillment of the Old Testament. Let's turn to Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrews chapter 1, and we'll read verses 1 and 2. He says, God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds." And so here the Apostle Paul is affirming that God spoke through those Old Testament prophets. And we're seeing the ultimate fulfillment of all that they preached and taught about in the very life of Jesus Christ. And Jesus speaks toward this in John chapter 12. If we could turn to John chapter 12, and I read verses 47 through 50. "And if any man hear my words and believe not, I judge him not, for I came not to judge the world, but to save the world. He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. For I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment, what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his commandment is life everlasting. Whatsoever I speak thereof, even as the Father said unto me, so I speak." And so God gave Jesus these words, and Jesus spoke these words. He said, "They are not my words." Now, as we've noticed already, there are certain warnings in the Scriptures about changing the Scriptures or adding to the Scriptures. And perhaps one of the strongest and most forthright warnings is found in the book of Revelation, chapter 22. So let's turn back to Revelation chapter 22 and verses 18 and 19. In verse 18, John writes, "For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book." Now, this begs for me to speak just for a minute about Bible translations. Bible translations. And some of the different texts or codexes from which the Scriptures have been translated. And when you look at some of the texts like the Vaticanus and the Sinaiticus and the so-called critical texts that have been built upon them, there are many sections and almost even whole verses in places that are totally omitted that we find in our King James Bible today. And they're taking away those things. And then there are times when people translate and they take things out. And when I was in Martinique and in Guadeloupe recently, French-speaking areas, and I was preparing presentations with slides and having French verses on them because I had an electronic version of French Bible. I had two different French Bibles. And I realized that these Bibles in places were taking away from the Word of God. For instance, in John 3:16, one of the Bibles that I was using was translated from the Textus Receptus. But when it came to John 3:16, it just said his only son. It didn't say his only begotten son. It totally left the word out. It didn't even try to translate it something else. It didn't try to make it unique or, you know, special or anything. It just said his only son. And that's taking away from the word of God. And there's a very fearful warning against this. Let's go to Galatians and see a case of this in practicality also. Galatians chapter 1. You have Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, and then Galatians in the New Testament. Chapter 1, and we're going to start in verse 6. So I'm going to read verses 6 through 9. Paul says, "I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed." And so, just pausing here, Paul's saying they're preaching another gospel, they're preaching something that's not in the Word. And in verse 9, "As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed." The Greek word is anathema. It's a very strong word in the Greek language. And in fact, in these verses, in verse 8 and verse 9, when it says, "let him be accursed," That is an imperative in the Greek. It's an imperative in the Greek. It's a command. Colossians chapter 2 and verse 18. He says, "Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind." Paul warns us to not let anyone to beguile us. And the way people so often beguile us is by altering, taking away, or adding to the Word of God and not accepting it for what it is. Let's turn to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto you, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit nor by word, nor by letter as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand." And so he's saying that in whatever form supposed inspiration comes, if it's not the genuine thing, don't be beguiled by it. Don't be shaken by it. Now let's look at some descriptions of the Scripture which point to its sufficiency. Characteristics of the Scriptures that help us to understand it is sufficient. The first one I want to look at is in Romans chapter 7 and verse 12. You probably are familiar with this. You probably have it maybe memorized, and memorization is good. They say the mind puzzles and all those things are good for your mind. And they do have a help, but they don't completely fix you. But one thing that has been found to help even more is hard aerobic exercise. People who do aerobic exercise on a regular basis have greater cognitive skills than those who don't. This has been studied and pretty well documented with control groups, taking groups that have basically an equal basis of cognitive abilities. This group doesn't do the exercising, this group does do the exercising, and the group that does aerobic exercising in 6 to 8 weeks, their cognitive abilities are doing better. So we know that it physically changes the brain. We know that it changes the brain in a way that it works better. Romans chapter 7, verse 12. "Wherefore the law is holy, and the commandment holy, and just and good." And so here, if it's holy and it's just and it's good, I mean, you can't want much more, can you? That really encompasses just about everything that it should and could be. But there's more. 1 Timothy 1:8. 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 8. He says, "But we know that the law is good if a man use it lawfully." He says, we know the law is good. We know that God's word is good. In Psalms 19 and verse 7, it says, "The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple." And so again, we have the law of the Lord is perfect, it's holy, it's just, it's good, it's righteous. In Psalms 119 and verse 142, "Thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and thy law is the truth." If you want to know what a definition of righteousness is, his law is the truth. All his commandments are righteousness, according to verse 172 there. The scripture is eternal. In the same chapter, if we go to verse 89, Psalms 119 and verse 89, it says, "Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven." For how long? Forever. Forever. In Matthew chapter 5 and verse 18, Jesus said that till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall nowise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Jesus said in Matthew 24:35, "Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away." And so we have the perpetuity of God's word. In 1 Peter chapter 1, we should take a minute and turn to this text. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 24 and 25. He says, "For all flesh is as grass." All flesh is as what? Grass. "And all the glory of man as the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away. But the word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you." Isn't that something? God's word's eternal, and it's not going to change. You know, sometimes people, they expect you to alter your Christian experience based upon circumstances. You get into a particular circumstance and they expect a different response from you than what you might normally be able to give. But if we are to be controlled by the Scriptures, friends, and the Scriptures don't change and the Scriptures stand forever, then our responses should be uniform, they should be consistent, and they should be in harmony with what the Word of God says. Let's turn to one more verse, and this is a parallel to what we just read in Peter, and this is Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 40. And here we see Peter's inspiration. Isaiah chapter 40 and verses 6 through 8. The voice said, "Cry." And he said, "What shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all the goodliness thereof is as the flower of the field. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon it. Surely the people is grass. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever." Now, in Ellen White's first vision, she has this vision and she sees herself in heaven and she picks some flowers. Do you remember what she said about those flowers?
They never die.
They won't fade. She says they'll never fade. But on this earth, the grass withers and the flowers fade. But the word of God, friends, it stands forever and ever. And the Scripture is its own sufficiency. And as we study it, as we meditate upon it, our brains become smarter, sharper, keener. And if we will allow the Scriptures to shape our minds, they will become more noble and kingly bearing and able to rightly represent God, rightly able to give glory to Him and to share His last threefold warning with the world. So I want to encourage each one of you to study the Scriptures more, to meditate in them, to know what the Word of God says for yourself. Don't take anything just because I say it or some other preacher says it. Study what the Word of God says and find out for yourself. And as David says, taste and see if the Lord is not good. He is good. And you'll be greatly blessed as you study the Scriptures. And may God add a blessing to the reading of His Word. Thank you. Amen.